Why is God is going to judge us according to our works when the Bible tells us that we are not saved by works, but we are saved by what? Faith. All right, so let me just kind of clear that up this morning, because sometimes people don't think works are important. Okay, but there's a lot of scriptures that lets us know, amen, that God thinks a whole lot of what? Works. Is that right?
Yes.
He says, be careful to maintain good works. All right, that's in the Bible.
Yes.
That's Titus 3:8, Titus 2:7. In all things, showing thyself a pattern of good works. All right, Hebrews 10:24, provoke unto love and to good works. Amen. And Revelation 2:26, we talked about the overcomer. He was speaking about the overcomer. The letters that he wrote to the seven churches, in every letter he mentioned the importance of being an overcomer. Being an overcomer. Amen. To me, I take that to mean that those that overcome are going to be the recipients of all of the blessings, all of the blessings, all of the blessings, all of the rewards, and all that awaits us throughout eternity is waiting for the overcomers. So you want to make sure that you are an overcomer.
Amen.
How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right, now the verse, Revelation 2:26, he says, he that overcometh and keepeth my works. My works. He that keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. Okay, that means that you're going to share in the millennium reign with Christ, because he's going to give you power over the nations. He's going to give you power over the nations. And you're going to help Christ, amen, rule and reign the nations with a rod, with a rod of iron. It's going to be, amen, righteousness during that 1,000-year period of reign. Amen. Christ is going to reign, but we're going to be, what, ruling and reigning with him. Amen. The Bible says through the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, we reign in this life. But we're not going to just reign in this life, but we're going to reign with Christ throughout, what, the 1,000 years of what? Of the millennium. And we're going to be over people. He said, you're going to be sitting with me on my throne.
Praise God.
Amen. Now, depending on the extent of faithfulness, the commitment that you made to do the works of Christ, you know, it's going to depend the position of the degree of authority, or the degree of responsibility will be contingent upon, amen, the services that you rendered here. Amen. If you made full use of all that God has placed in your hand, if you use the gifts, the talents, the abilities, the time, the money, whatever God has given you, amen, to the fullest extent of your ability, then you're going to be counted worthy, amen, to have an abundant interest. Amen. So you won't scarcely scrape by. You know, there will be some people in heaven that will barely be there by the skin of their teeth. Amen. Y'all getting quiet on me now. Amen. Now, these are the people that, you know, they didn't take it. They weren't looking for the coming of Christ. They weren't making no provision. Because the Bible says every person that takes Christ's coming seriously, amen, they will purify themselves.
That's good. Amen.
Amen. They will what? Purify themselves. I mean, you're going to what? Work on yourself.
Yes.
Bible says work out your soul salvation with what? Fear and what? Trembling.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And this doctrine of the imminence of Christ is very important, because if you don't take that seriously, that Christ could actually come any moment. See, actually, 6,000 prophecies throughout the Old Testament, New Testament, Jesus talked about it over and over. All of these prophecies pretty well, all of them, except for what Paul revealed through, amen. I mean, Paul had a revelation. I mean, God showed him this mystery. He was the only apostle that had the mystery. He had a revelation that Christ is going to, before he comes back to the earth to reign, amen, the 1,000-year period, before he comes back to the earth to judge the nations, before he comes back to the earth, amen, praise God, to stop the bloodshed and what? Amen, and destroy the Antichrist and all of these armies that has arrayed themselves against the nation of Israel. That's the purpose of his what? Second coming back to the earth. Amen. And after he takes care of business, amen, destroy the nation, judge the nation, put down the Antichrist, put him in the lake of fire, praise God, and judge the goat nations, and throw them in, amen, and in eternal punishment, and amen, and take the, amen, those that were saved during the tribulation period, he's going to take them into the millennium kingdom, and there they're going to what? Reign. But we're going to be what? They're reigning with Christ. We're going to be right by his side. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. So I want to admonish you that this thing is going to be unexpected. Amen. 6,000 signs pointing to Christ is coming back to the earth. See, if everybody's looking at those signs, well, this can't happen now because the Antichrist hasn't been revealed. It can't happen now because the war, the power of the Antichrist is supposed to take peace from the earth. When he comes, he's just going to stir up a whole lot of what? Confusion. And pestilences and the sword and famine and all, and martyrdom. Be millions martyred during that period of time because the Antichrist is going to demand what? Worship. Amen. You're not going to be able to, you don't want to be here when this occurred. I can give you a whole, if I wanted to give you some reasons, all I would have to do is just go down the list. The six seals, the six trumpets, and the six bowls. That showed you do not want to be left behind. 6,000, see, people just got their eyes on, this got to happen, that's got to happen, this got to happen, all these things got to happen. So they said, well, I can do my thing much longer because I'm looking at the signs, but all these signs are pointing to the second coming, the coming of Christ to the earth. See, Christ only, he came to the earth when he was born in Bethlehem. Is that right?
Yes, amen.
He's coming back to the earth when he comes to judge and set up his millennium reign. Those are only two comings of Christ to the earth. But Paul said, behold, I show you a mystery.
Yes, hallelujah.
All right. That coming was not to the earth. That was a coming in the air. And those that are dead in Christ will what? Rise first.
Yes.
And they that are alive shall be changed in the twinkling of an eye.
Glory.
And they will, this is what the scripture says in 1 Corinthians 15:51-54 and 1 Thessalonians 4:13-17. Both describes the same event. Paul had the mystery. Christ is going to come before he comes back to the earth to judge. He's going to come back for his saints to snatch them away. In the twinkling of an eye, 1/1000th of a second, according to General Electric calculation. And they're going to be what? Caught up to meet the Lord in the air. Amen. Guess how many prophecies there has been that talked about that. Only Paul had the mystery. Behold, I show you a mystery. The only other writer that spoke about The rapture or the catching away of the saints was John. And Jesus was speaking through John. He said, "Behold, I go away and prepare a place. And if I go and prepare a place, I'm going to what? I'm going to come again." And this is what he said. "And I'm going to receive you unto what? Myself. So where I am," he's speaking about in heaven, "there ye may be" what? "Also." Okay, that's the time we are snatched away, taken to heaven, to be examined for the services and the works that we perform on the behalf of Christ while we were here on this earth. It will take a period of time. That's the reason why I don't believe that the post-trib rapture could hold in the water, because if Christ came and took us all away, you got to what? Judge us. I mean, so people that believe that it's going to all happen at the end of this tribulation period, that means that everybody will be what? Caught up. Then they'll come right back down. The yo-yo theory. They're caught up. Everybody caught up. Then they come right back down. Now, where's the time to be judged? It takes time to examine God's people. Plus, it's going to be a what? A marriage. To the what? The bride is going to be married to the Lamb. All that's got to take place before the millennium reign, what, begins, kick in. Amen. So that goes back to let you know the only other time that Jesus spoke about, any other writer spoke about the mystery. John said that, he says that in John 11, just turn there for me, just a minute, I believe it's John 11. He said, "I am the resurrection," watch this, "I am the resurrection and the life." Now, I want to bring this down home to you, because, see, if you're looking for some sign, the mid-trib people say, well, Christ is going to come at the end of the seventh trumpet. When the seventh trumpet sound, that's when they call it the mid-trib view. But if you, nobody had to believe that anyway, but if you did believe that mid-trib view, that means that it would take away the imminency of what? Christ's return. See, the forefathers, all of them, from the time that we read about, I'm going to show you some scriptures in a minute, that even the apostles, they were looking for the imminent return of Christ. See, the Papaya, that was one of the early fathers named Papaya, he said that he knew all of the 12 disciples of Jesus. He knew each and every one of them. And he had talked with every one of them. And he knew what they taught. And this is what he said. All of Jesus' 12 disciples believed that there would be a rapture. And in their day and in their time and in their era, they considered the coming of Christ as being what? Imminent. So you don't want to take away the what? The imminency. Because if you take away the imminency, that means that what? Well, he's going to come way down the line. Man, I got a whole lot of time to do my stuff. But there's no sign. There's nothing that has to be revealed, has to be fulfilled. There's no event that has to take place to take us away to be with the Lord. But there are a whole bunch of stuff got to be fulfilled before Christ comes back with us. Heaven. Amen. To rule and to what? And to reign. So that's the reason why when I read that scripture, the first night we had our lesson on Revelation, it was Revelation 1:3. That got my attention. Boy, every day, you know what I'm telling myself? I said, man, I better watch everything I do. I better watch my thought life. And when I pray, because one of the warnings that he gave to the church at Ephesus, he says that because you have left your first love. He said, repent and do your first works over. He said, you have left because I have one thing against you, that you have what? Left the first love. That lets me know that a lot of times we don't consider the loss of our fervency and zeal. We're not nearly like we were when we first started out. The Bible says the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. That's what I began to sense this week, especially in the early morning prayer. I heard weeping, crying. I heard people returning to their pure and sincere devotion to Christ. The Bible says the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous.
Yes.
It avails much. And I think in order to be able to win souls and to get people's attention, you gotta have the Holy Ghost and fire. You gotta be on fire. Let me tell you, the Laodicean church was the church that Christ rejected. He rejected them straight out because thou art neither what? Hot or cold. Because you were not hot or cold, I will what? Spew you. So I went through all of those letters that John wrote to those seven churches, and I tried to locate myself. In every area, one church, he said, you have the name that you live, but in reality, you are dead. And see, when we come up here, and y'all be looking at whoever is doing the praise and worship, looking like a calf, looking at a new gate. Bit more doing this stuff from your heart. The Bible says, whatever you do, do it what? Heartily.
Yes, amen.
As if you were doing it to Christ.
Amen.
See, we lost something. But a lot of us can't tell it. Because it's what? It's kind of business as usual. Amen. But the Bible is still saying, Revelation 1:3. Well, that got my attention that night. I want you to see what got my attention. I want you to see what got my attention. The first night of our study on the book of Revelation, it was the third verse in the first chapter. It says this: blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things. So it's not the doer, it's not the hearer of the word that is what? Justified before God. See, salvation, trusting God by faith, that's all you have to do to get saved, right? Believe in your heart that what? Jesus died and rose again. Amen. With your heart, man believe with the heart, man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. We are saved by what? Faith through grace. And that not of yourselves. It is the what? There's nothing you can do to marry salvation. Believing is the only thing you can do without doing anything to tell the truth. So all you have to do is believe from your heart and confess Christ with your mouth. That's the thing that enables you to enter into the kingdom of God. It's not by works, lest any man should what? Boast. But the works is the proof that you are what? It's a demonstration of your what? Faith. It shows that you were changed. It shows that you do have what? New life. It shows that you have been what? Born again. Your works done. I mean, how you live and how you what? Obey and walk before the Lord. That is the demonstration. Those are the works that you got to have. Bible says we are his workmanship created unto Christ, unto good works. Where before I have what? Ordained that ye may what? Walk it. You gotta live. So you can't be thinking about becoming an overcomer if you're not living a nickel worth of dog meat. If you're not living nothing,
Whatever Christ says to do. Amen. So that scripture, blessed is he that readeth, and they that what? Hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written, for the time is at hand. That's the thing that got 19. For the time is at hand. In other words, the time is what? Imminent. It's imminent. Even back there, probably around 100 AD, when John died, he said, my coming is what? Imminent. You got to consider my coming as what? Being what? Imminent.
Yes.
Amen. Now, let me just give you some more scriptures on the imminent factor that I want to put a lot of emphasis on. All right? Philippians 3:20. Now, this is a passage that was written during the early era of the church. Philippians 3:20 and 21, Titus 2:11 through 13. Now, those are some scriptures we'll show you. You can just turn there. Philippians 3:20 and Titus 2:13. Philippians 3:20, it says this: for our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Way back in that day, they were looking for, because the Lord told them that his coming would be what? Imminent. There's no sign that has to take place before Jesus comes back. And that's more applicable to us. You could say, rationalize, you could just say that, well, if people in that day, if they knew all of the events that took place just before the coming of Christ to the earth, like we know. See, we are privileged because actually about 20 years ago, no more than 20 or 30 years ago, you could really, Revelation became unsealed. You could really understand this stuff now, because everything around you is pointing to the fact that what? The 7-year tribulation is what? It could be, as they have predicted, that the peace, they're putting pressure on a certain person. Amen. A lot of Arab nations, a lot of nations, the EU, they're putting pressure on a certain leader to step up to the plate and get Israel to what? Sign a what? Peace pact. They are pushing for 2012 on that. They are pushing for 2012. So in our day, in light of all of the things that's going to happen, especially Israel returning back to their native homeland in 48, but the real clincher was that when they came back in 67, they regained control over what? Jerusalem. See, everything is centered around Israel and Jerusalem. Jerusalem.
Yes, yes.
Amen. Praise God. So everything hinges on Jerusalem. And Jesus said that the nations, amen, he says that when you see Israel back into their homeland and back in control of their capital, Jerusalem, he said, I want you to know that this generation will not pass away until all of these things, sand in the sun, sand in the moon, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves rolling, the earthquakes in diverse places. Now, the scientists are saying, people are saying all kind of things, but a lot of this is scientific. They're saying the year 2012 is the year you want to watch, because they're saying that there's that the scientists are saying the earth is tilting, and the North Pole and the South Pole will what? Trade places, and when that happens, it's going to be a great upheaval, and something catastrophic will happen that will trigger, a series of earthquakes and a series of tsunamis at the same time. What we saw in Japan a couple of weeks ago, it was just what? One earthquake and one tsunami. What would happen if all of these eruptions actions would take place. All of them are connected to each other some kind of way. That thought is running all over the world. Now suppose they will erupt at the same time. How many tsunamis do you think that it would trigger? That's what scientists are saying. Now, the sixth day theory says that 2,000, but they said you have to give up to about 17 or 18 years because when the calendar switched from AD, from BC to AD, then there were some years that were kind of, lost, up to about 17, so you have to give or take about 17 or 18 years. But this six-day theory goes way, way back to all of the church fathers saying 6 days, God is going to create the earth and all of the nations and the empires and everything that God wills that will take place. But the end of the sixth day and the beginning of the seventh day, when God is going to set up his millennial reign. So that kind of put things down, it kind of bring things down to the white. See, we're in a better position today. And if we would say, if the tribulation is supposed to be 7 years before Christ comes back to the earth, that means the rapture has to take place just before that 7 year period. So if we could just say, right now, the average one of us can figure out, because if he says 67, even the countdown, our generation is only, 51 or 52 years. You can see that we're at the brink of what? Something, something really big is going to happen. Something is going to, happen. We can just feel it and sense it. Amen. Praise God. Now, but people back in 100 AD, all of this hadn't even evolved. So they could have, if they had revelation, perhaps they could have said, all of this can't happen because the tsunamis and all the earthquakes and Israel hadn't gotten back into their homeland. They're not under the control of Jerusalem. They probably could have rationalized, but the word says that you always want to consider the coming of Jesus for the saints as being what? Imminent. How many believe that? Imminent. Okay, now, I'm not done. Philippians 3:20. Does that seem like they believe it was imminent? Who shall change out of our body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he able even to subdue all things unto himself. Titus 2:11, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of what? Good work. And we're called in that particular passage to live our lives soberly, righteously, and godly. Looking for. Amen. If you are looking for, you're not just going to be sitting up here acting half dead and won't praise God, won't magnify God. Amen. It's going to take every bit of all of the worship you can do in order to be prepared for Christ when he comes back. How many can say amen? He's coming back for what? Overcomers. Lift your hands and he's coming back for an overcomer. He's coming back for what? An overcomer. The scripture says we overcome him, the devil, by the what? Blood of the Lamb and the what? Word of our testimony. We got to live the life. We got to stay ready. Bible says, watch and pray because you do not know the day nor the hour that the Son of Man would come. And all he just told us to do is what? Watch. Be ready. Whatever you're doing that's not consistent with the Word of God, you want to get that thing what? Right. See, the reason why James was a book that nobody understood because it put a lot of emphasis on what works. And even Martin Luther was one of the greatest reformers that we have ever had. He said that the book of James should even be in the Bible. Because he didn't understand that, that faith, salvation by faith and works are two different things, it's two sides of the same coin, right? He didn't understand how it works. Because in the book of James, James was talking about if you say you are what? Saved. If you say you have faith, amen, and you are not what? Living and demonstrate the faith that you say you have, your faith is all in what? Vain. Faith without what? Works is what? Dead. Amen. The book of James is just telling you, if you say you have faith and you believe God, you're born again, you're changed, and your works, and amen, is not lining up with what you're what? Confessing. Amen. You can what? Forget about it. Hallelujah. So, faith without works. It's not the hearer of the word that is justified before God. It's the what? It's the doer. How many can say, he that looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continue therein, being not a forgetful hearer, being a what? Doer of the work and not a forgetful hearer, that man shall be what? Blessed in all of his deeds. He's going to be the one that will overcome. Amen. Praise God. I want everybody to stand with me. It's going to take Wednesday night. We're going to get more into the coming of Christ and the rapture. We're going to get more into the events that's going to trigger in the seven years of tribulation. Amen. We're almost at that point. Amen. The open door, Revelation 1, when that voice was heard, come up hither. Come up hither. Amen. The coming of the Lord is not. Suppose he came tonight. Suppose he came first thing in the morning before we even got up. Bible says he's coming as a thief in the night. Amen. When you least expect, I'm just envisioning. Suppose I be driving down the street. Boom! Boy, you're gone. Boy, the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to look around for my wife. I'm going to say, where's my wife? Hey, hallelujah, hallelujah. It's going to be soon. Just going to be soon and very soon. We are going to what? See the King. And I want you to know, if you plan to pray, how can you prepare without praying? It's the effectual, fervent prayer. That's the reason why somebody's going to have to what? Shed some tears. It's going to have to be what? Some brokenness. It's going to have to be some repentance. It's going to be have to be someone returning and amen, turning back to God. It takes brokenness. That's what the sacrifices of God are. Amen. I want everybody, amen, lift your hands right now. Tomorrow night, we're going to be seeking God. Amen. We might not have but a year, two or three years. Might not even have even a month. But I believe that the little time that we have, we ought to what? We ought to take full advantage of the time that God has what? Has given us. Don't just sit at home and watch television when prayer's going on. I can't understand folk now. I just don't understand people. So that's the reason why Scripture says, he that has what? Ear. Let him what?
Ear.
He that has what?
Ear.
Amen. Last week, I know somebody that have no ears. Amen. Even the Bible says, obey them that have what? Rule over you. I can see things coming that you can't see. He's placed me as a shepherd. He's going to reward me according to how I have what? Amen. Watched over and warned and exhorted you and amen. And did everything that I could do to compel you. Amen. So that's not good. That's not good. Because many of you are not really following me. You're following your own way. See, the Bible says, submit yourself unto God. Amen. And resist the devil and he will what? Submit to God means what? You got to submit to what? God. You got to submit to Christ. You got to submit to the Holy Ghost. You got to submit to the what? Word of God. And you got to submit to what? The authority that God has placed over you down here in the fivefold ministry capacity. Means what? Submitting to God. And the Bible says if you submit to God, then and only then will you be able to resist the devil. And the devil will what? Flee from you. Amen. About probably 90% of resisting the devil is obedience. Some people think hollering and screaming and kicking the devil in his butt. And it's obeying. It's obeying, doing what God said. That's where your authority lies in what? Obedience. Obedience. Amen. Father, today we thank you, God, for the spirit of revival. Restoring the spirit of prayer. Lord, if we're going to be at our best, we have to pray, God, in sincerity. You said for us to be sincere and without offense until the day and the coming of Jesus. Lord, you said us for us to return and do our first works over again. The passion we had, the burden we carried, the love that we demonstrated, the obedience that we fulfilled, the love for God, the willingness to deny the flesh and take up the cross and follow you. That's the works that we need to do all over again. Lord, what about that loved one? What about that friend? What about that neighbor? What about those acquaintances that have never heard that Jesus would ever come again, period? Lord, we need fire. We need motivation. We need zeal. We need to be stirred. We need to be seeking your face. Father, let tomorrow night be the night that we will return and make a firm commitment to return to our first love and to start doing our first works all over again. Because if we fail to heed, fail to obey, Jesus, you're going to come. And you mention those that do not overcome, their names will be blotted out of the book of life. And I believe names can be blotted out. I believe that we can lose our rewards. And I believe that if we don't add faith and works together, Father, we can find ourselves not even on the foundation that you have even laid for us. Father, we give you praise. We give you the glory right now. In Jesus' name. Everybody just say, in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Jesus' name. If there's anybody in the house that feels the need of salvation at this time, I want you to lift your hands. Pastor, I feel the need of receiving Christ into my life. I know that he died for me, paid the price, the just for the unjust, to bring me to God. I want to make that commitment today to serve Christ and to turn to him, because only security that we have, the only hope, the Bible calls Jesus the blessed hope. If we don't get saved now, when do we plan to get saved? Some say, well, I get saved if Jesus comes back and leave me here, I'm left behind, I'll really get serious then. But let me tell you, the church will be gone. The influence of the Holy Spirit through the church, of the Holy Ghost, won't be taken away from the earth. But it's going to be the influence that we exert on the earth as believers, that influence will be taken. And I don't know what you could do. We can't do it with all the saints around you. You can't do it with a church full of people that's saved through the Holy Spirit. I wonder how you're going to thrive when nobody was counted worthy that you'll be around. How do you feel that you're going to survive then? The lukewarms will remain. The half-hearted will remain. Those living in sin will remain. Those rejecting Christ will remain. So you're going to be around, amen, a church we call is going to be what? A world church. I guess we see a whole lot of world churches right now. Amen. People just come on in. They don't have to live a nickel worth of nothing. They don't have to what? Amen. Praise God. Do nothing but what? Sign in and put them, get their names on the roll and start paying the money. It's going to be a lukewarm, cold, heartless. It's going to be an environment. But there are going to be 144 evangelists that's going to be spreading the word all over the world. But yet, The Antichrist is going to be what? He's going to be what? Taking the lives of those who have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Amen. So I believe today is your best time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Behold, now is the accepted time. Amen. Those that want to be closer to the Lord, just lift your hands right now. Say, Pastor, I want to be closer. And I'm going to start doing the things that will draw me closer. I'm going to submit my way to God. Father, I thank you right now in Jesus' name. I want to get a commitment from all of you that